In the subject of who is my neighbor, we looked at the parable of the Good Samaritan in particular in our previous sessions and examined how the question that the lawyer asked Jesus Christ about inheriting eternal life, and Jesus asked him, which are the two great commandments? And he answered, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And then Jesus used the parable to explain this to him. And he spoke about a man going from Jerusalem to Jericho. And historically, as I mentioned in the previous session, that Jericho was a meeting point to then go to Galilee from Jerusalem, or from the province of Judea where Jerusalem was located, into the province of Galilee. And most people would do that to bypass an area called Samaria, which Jews avoided because of Gentile and Jews having a long-standing break in their relationships. So this morning, I want to talk to you about how we all need to go through our Samaria. In John chapter 4, verse number 3 to 4, the Bible says he left Judea and departed to Galilee. Now, this is the same journey that the man is taking from Jerusalem to Jericho, and I'll explain to you why shortly. He left Judea and departed again to Galilee. Verse 4 says, but he needed to go through Samaria. Let me read it in two other versions for you. The King James Version says, and he must needs go through Samaria. The New International Version says, now he had to go through Samaria. In the parable of the Good Samaritan, you see the man going from Jerusalem to Jericho because he wants to avoid going through Samaria. But here in John chapter 4, as Jesus is with his disciples, the Bible says he was leaving Judea. Now, the three main provinces during the time of Jesus was Judea, was Galilee, and was Samaria. Galilee was the place where people were brought up, and you would read of the disciples of Jesus having their businesses there. They were called the sons of Galilee. Jesus was called a Galilean because this was the place of their upbringing. Judea was the province where Jerusalem was located, and so people would often make their journey to go to Jerusalem to gather for the feasts, to have fellowship. It was a corporate place. It was also the place of worship. Samaria, on the other hand, was the rejected place because of the Samaritan population. So Jews would avoid the area of Samaria, and therefore they would bypass it by going from Jerusalem to Galilee to Jericho before going to Galilee, which is their home province. In this particular portion of scripture in John chapter 4, we see a difference where Jesus is saying that he needs to go through Samaria. Now, the word needs in this particular portion of scripture, or needed to go through, is actually the word, it was necessary, it was inevitable, it was a sense of duty, it must be done, it was unavoidable, and many other words that would sort of portray something that was very essential for Jesus to do. Now, the difference between the man going from Jerusalem to Jericho and Jesus going from Judea to Galilee is that Jesus is saying that he needs to go through Samaria. Now remember, Jesus is the fulfillment of the law. And by going through Samaria, he was demonstrating how we should love our neighbors as we love ourselves. And he found this as a duty. He found this as something that should be unavoidable. It's something that was necessity. So my point to you this morning is that we all have a Samaria in our lives, and sometimes we avoid it. And I'm talking to you about your Samaria in the context of loving your neighbor. And so we find ourselves avoiding our Samaria in our lives and choosing to meet at our Jericho and bypass Samaria so that we can go to our place of upbringing, our place of safety, our place of comfort, which is Galilee. So Jerusalem would represent the church. It would represent a place of fellowship. It would represent a place of strength, a place of growth. Jericho would represent a place also of meeting your fellow brethren and then going into Galilee, your hometown, or your place of safety, or your place of upbringing. But oftentimes we avoid the Samaritan issue. We avoid the place that sort of makes us uncomfortable. We avoid the place that sort of get into the deeper issues in our lives. So I want to lay a foundation today about the history of Samaria and talk about how do we deal with the Samaritan issue in our last session next week. The history of Samaria is such that it was established as a capital of what was then known as the Northern Kingdom. Remember that after Solomon's rule, when his son Rehoboam took over as being king of Israel, there was a split in the kingdom and it was prophesied. So 10 tribes joined Jeroboam and the rest of the tribes of the two tribes joined Rehoboam, and it became known as the Northern and the Southern Kingdom. So the Northern Kingdom was actually known as Israel and the Southern Kingdom was known as Judah. So under the Northern Kingdom, during the time of the reign of Asa, who was the king of Judah, and Judah is the Southern Kingdom, 1 Kings 16:23 will tell you that Omri became the king of Israel and he reigned for 12 years. And 6 years he reigned in Tirzah. And then in verse 24 of 1 Kings 16, the Bible says he bought the hill of Samaria. And on this hill, he built a city. And this Samaria now became the capital city of the Northern Kingdom. It was the epicenter of the Northern Kingdom. And many kings, including Omri, continued to walk in what was called the sin of Jeroboam. Remember that Jeroboam was the first king of the Northern Kingdom. And when he became king, what he immediately did is he separated the 10 tribes from the two tribes by creating two altars, one in Dan and one in Bethel, so that the people did not need to go to Jerusalem to worship, but they would worship at Dan and Bethel, and kept the nation from being together. He created sort of an isolation from Judah so that they did not have to meet together at Jerusalem. This act became known as the Way of Jeroboam and was passed down to many kings, including Omri. Now you need to remember that Omri's son, King Omri, his son's name was Ahab, and many of us are familiar with King Ahab, and Ahab was married to a woman called Jezebel. So when Samaria was established and Jezebel came into rule, she established Baal worship. She put in idols and many images in Samaria. And this location became pivotal for legislation, for justice, for administration and rulership. But it was now plagued with mixture of idolatry and false worship. And it was in competition with Jerusalem, which was regarded as the center or the epicenter of worship for all of Israel. So a hybrid culture was introduced and was further enhanced when the city was captured by the Assyrians. Later on, the city of Samaria was captured by the Assyrians. And so what the Assyrian king did is, in the book of 2 Kings 7:24, 1724, then the king of Assyria brought people from Babylon, Cutha, Ahava, Hamath and Sepharvaim and placed them in the cities of Samaria instead of the children of Israel, and they took possession of Samaria and dwelt in the city. So these people groups that came from different regions, which were under the rulership of Assyria, came into Samaria and created a hybrid culture. Now, why am I creating this background for you? You see, during the time of Christ, Samaria now evolved in its and matured in its mixture and was filled with a very great hybrid culture. And if you relate that to our time, when I talk about going through your Samaria, we find ourselves in such a time in a postmodern world. Such a culture produces a Samaritan way of thinking. In a postmodern culture, we are dealing now with the isms of life. The humanism, the universalism, communism, socialism, statism, which is where the state wants to control, denominationalism, commercialism, etc. So the travel from Galilee to Judea and vice versa, you had to go through Samaria, but many people avoided it. But yeah, Jesus is saying you need to go through your Samaria. As believers in Christ, we are now faced with the post-modern Samaria of today. And the church has moved into what we call a progressive Christianity thinking, and the church has developed a greater desire to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And in this culture that we have, how do we love our neighbors within the context of a post-modern thinking world? Remember, the mixture now is interfaith movements. The sectarianism is now seen as far-right extremism. The modern family issue is where basic family values are being redefined. Even holy matrimony is being redefined. The hyper-grace movement, the corruption that we see and bribery that has overtaken the entire world. We have Generation Z, which is made themselves God. That's why you have a selfie generation, a selfish generation that is in love with themselves. We have radicalism, ultra-orthodox religion, factionalism, where there's divisions, etc. And a whole list of postmodern issues that we are facing in this world. And it is in that kind of context that we have to go through our own Samaria and still fulfill the royal law of loving your neighbor. Now, Jesus, in the book of Luke chapter 9, verse 51 to 53, was set on going to Jerusalem, and he was going from Galilee to Jerusalem. In Luke 9:51, now it came to pass when the time had come for him to be received up, that he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, and sent messengers before his face, and as they went, they entered the village of the Samaritans to prepare for him. But they did not receive him, because his face was set for the journey of Jerusalem. Now, basically, the Samaritans did not want to receive Jesus, because he was journeying from Galilee to Jerusalem. You see, the church is now the heavenly Jerusalem. We are now the holy nation. We are now the city of God that is born out of God. We live in the cities of men. And we must express the love for God and the love for our neighbors. While we have a quest to pursue Jerusalem values, and when I'm using the word Jerusalem, I'm talking about the church, which is the new Jerusalem. While we are pursuing our goals in establishing the church and its values and its morals and its ethics, we cannot avoid our Samaria. We have to face our Samaria and we have to go through it. So next week, please join me as I will talk about some of the solutions in dealing with the Samaritan issues that we are facing and how do we love our neighbors within this postmodern world. God bless you. Amen.